Anyway, so a little bit about myself. My name's David Inman. I'm a chartered environmental surveyor working in private practice, my own firm based down in Formby. I'm also a member of RICS Northwest Regional Board. Are there any RICS members in the room? I know there's a few. So if you've got any problems with the organisation, come speak to me in private. But we're a global profession, and at the front of our profession are ethics and professionalism, because as a chartered surveyor, we are governed by a royal charter, which its underlying principle is to protect the public. That's what the chartered surveyor is in the world for. So about myself, I'm a specialist chartered environmental surveyor, qualified auditor, various other things, do a bit of lecturing at university. In terms of my professional life, environmental management, energy management, quality management, which is very interesting because the banner behind us for the business growth programme, New Markets 2, Liverpool City Region SMEs can get public sector funding to develop a quality management system. If that interests you, please speak to Colin. He'll expertly signpost you as he always does to services within the wider city region. And we also forget, you know, Liverpool, as our Metro Mayor said at the BID event last year, we are the brand. Well, you know, yes, it's an international city. But Sefton is a very key component of the city region. Little digress there, politically. Do lots of training, both online and in person, clients on various technical subjects, and also support clients in the workplace activities, mainly around application of facilities management, which is a broad and sometimes challenging subject. In terms of location, I work all across the UK. I would like to say that I've visited all the countries in green. I've supported UK clients in their overseas operations throughout the world. But what is the common thread through this is the consistency in delivering professional ethics and professionalism. This presentation, you're all professionals, you will all be acting ethically. My presentation is to share my experiences and some tools that I use and advise businesses on to both underpin your ethical and professional rationale and reasoning, but also to develop your businesses in this area. So, as a chartered surveyor, our professional and ethical standards really reinforce that we act with integrity, trust, and respect. But when we break this down, quite simply, this is the difference between right or wrong. My two-year-old kind of knows the difference between right or wrong. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. But as professionals, we can bring into this ethical reasoning. So when we're deciding if anything's right or wrong, we bring ethics into it. Now, I've turned down lots of work over the years because, quite frankly, whilst I could have a stab at it and muddle through it, I'm not insured. So that's my initial ethical compass. Can I do it, and am I insured to do it? Under my professional indemnity insurance. That's my initial ethical decision. I know people who, quite frankly, never stab at anything. Can you do a contaminated land evaluation? Oh yes, I'll have to do it at that. I avoid things like that because I would double my professional indemnity insurance premium and add a zero to it. Leave that to the people who can afford £15,000 a year indemnity insurance premiums. But as professionals, the reasoning between right and wrong, well, it depends. And that's where a lot of us bring our professional judgment into it. I've advised clients who are breaking the law. But my professional judgment swings them the other way. I give the ethical reasoning to it, and I make them complaints, and I advise to make them complaints. So, yes, is it right to represent a business who's breaking the law? But my professional reasoning will say, well, if I advise them, they'll become compliant. So that's why us as professionals, we make these decisions. And at the end of the day, it all boils down to our integrity. Somebody said to me, do you sleep well at night? Well, I sleep really well at night, to be honest, because I know what I'm doing is right, I know what I'm doing is insured, and I know that I'm competent to carry out my professional tasks for clients on behalf of clients. And this is really a large area of self-reflection. And again, would you be happy for any of the work you do to end up in the press? If you're representing a client and you were quoted in the press, would you be happy on it? Yes, because I acted professionally, diligently, objectively, within my competence. In terms of the actual rationale of ethics, I think of it as a flower with ethics at the centre. So at the top, we've got law, the law of the land, in whichever country we're operating in. We get slightly further afield from the UK, and what may be considered unethical in the UK may be normal business practices. That's just the world. Completely different. And somebody's not put the batteries in, so I've got a free hand now to wave around. I'll speak up a little bit. So, the law of the land may vary in other territories around the world. Next, your own personal and professional values. There's nothing wrong with bringing some personal values into your work life. And then research. Do you have the market intelligence to provide the emotional intelligence for the advice you're giving professionally? And next, moral principles. Looking at the ethical balance. Looking at the reasons why you're advising certain clients, which may be on unpalatable reasons. What you're advising a client on may result in people losing their jobs. Well, as long as you act professionally and objectively on behalf of the client, that's your decision whether you want to work for that client. And ethical practices. Whichever sector we're working, there will be understood and expected ethical practices for that sector. And from my, Ian and Paul's point of view as chartered surveyors, rules of conduct. If we're members of professional bodies, they will have specific and quite prescribed rules of conduct. So swinging back to our ICS as an example, we've got 5 ethical and professional standards, which kind of reflect what I've just been talking about. Act with integrity, always provide a high standard of service, act in a way that promotes trust in the profession, treat others with respect, and take responsibility. Take responsibility means if you've seen something wrong, flag it up. Now, our ICS published what's called the Ethical Decision Tree, which is quite a good tool, to be honest. I'm just going to share this with you just for a couple of minutes. And it's about when you engage with a new client or a new customer, just protecting yourselves and your business. So your first question is, do I have sufficient facts to take on that professional instruction? If you don't proceed. You know, you don't want to bumble into some work not knowing you've not got the resources or the competence or the ability to deliver it. But by doing this, try and separate any emotional response from the facts. I'm quite lucky I get on with all my clients. In the past, some clients have been slightly more challenging than others. But try and separate the emotions and, you know, the personal likes and dislikes from making the initial decision to engage on an assignment. The next big question is it legal? Not necessarily what your clients do, because you may be giving them advice, and I definitely give companies advice on how they can become compliant, maybe when they're falling a little bit short. But ask yourself, is what you're doing legal? And again, simple yes and no. But if it's not, if you're not sure, can you get more advice? And this is where your market intelligence comes in, and the understanding of your competency and your service delivery. And of course, if it's not, don't proceed. But if it is, run it through again. Just double check whether what you're doing is within the realms of legality. Specific to us, does it fall within our ICS professional and ethical standards? We're quite lucky as a profession, we have professional standards that are mandatory, so we have lots of prescribed rules for things. Again, simple traffic lights. The important, have you consulted with the appropriate people to make that informed decision. You may want to speak again to the client. You may want to speak to somebody else within the client, your own organisation. So have you made an informed decision in this? But when doing this, have you assessed the risks involved to your business in taking on this new assignment? It may be a financial risk. It may be a legal risk. It may be a reputational risk. Do you want to have your name dragged through the mud with this client who's getting prosecuted left, right and centre? That's your decision. And have you considered what the options are? The option in all this is saying, no thanks, sorry, I'm not available to do that. You know, don't be frightened to turn work down that you're not able to perform, not competent to do. And when I say not competent, that's not meant in a bad way. You know the limits of your competency. And have you had clear reasoning in reaching your decision? It's the people who go, yeah, I'll be there tomorrow, and it's all a big rush. When you're pricing for work, when you're quoting for work, clear, transparent decision making. At the end of the day, the decision can always be, no thanks, my company doesn't do that sort of work. Again, a simple yes or no. But you've got to think, is your decision informed? Are you bringing in the market intelligence, or your professional knowledge to make that decision? And you decide what your action is going to be. But don't forget to record the decision. Because if anything goes awry, it's a paper trail. I've mentioned this before, would you be content for your actions to be made public? Some of us may be involved in public sector schemes. We may be involved in schemes which undertakes development control, so they're in the public realm. Would you be happy, you know, contentious developments and the like? Would you be happy to be associated with that? And that's your call as business leaders. And it's yes, acts, but always reflect on the outcome, both for future business intelligence and also for next year's insurance proposal. Every year, I've got to send to my insurance, professional indemnity insurance broker, a list of my business risks, type of clients, type of industry, and I do it as I go along, or else it's a pretty thankless task every March. So it reflects, constant reflection of your work is very healthy. I've mentioned choice of values, we're very heavily regulated, and there's separate regulation for members and for firms. Most chartered surveyors don't work for RICS regulated firms. I do, so I'm applicable to both these. Now, if you're engaging with a firm of chartered surveyors, the conduct of business is about how we apply our ethics. So if we're handling client money, are we doing it transparently and legally? Do we have the right level of professional indemnity insurance to protect you as the clients or consumers if we're dealing with the public? And that if staff are competent, and if there are complaints, they're handled professionally and successfully. And again, there's mandatory guidance for how we market ourselves and how we deal with the public and how we manage your firms. I'm a sole practitioner. Unfortunately, I really don't understand, but if I was to fall off my perch, there are plans in place for a law firm to be brought in. So my client work could be continued for a period of time. I won't know about it, so it doesn't bother me. But there are arrangements in place, and there have to be arrangements in place to protect the public. On a wider realm, this nastily titled Countering Bribery, Corruption, Money Laundering and Terrorist Financing, this is a mandatory professional statement brought in recently by RICS to protect members and firms against all these things. Some chartered surveyors are exposed to this, and there are biscuit tins, you know, we've got away from the biscuit tin full of money to buy houses. Not allowed. But this, we are about, by protecting the profession, we're protecting the public. And at an international level, international ethical standards. So, all great stuff. But applying this, we're getting away from chance. So we're going to talk about bringing ethical principles into your businesses and how we're not reinventing the wheel. You can use the existing work you're doing to demonstrate, to market this. Now, I always think that whenever this big project comes out, such as the Olympics, the Olympics is a classic one, the next few years you'll start to have rather adventurous questions creep into tenders, copied and pasted from building the Olympic Stadium. Oh, we'll use their tender process. So you get small, family-run subcontractors being asked quite high-level, convoluted questions on their sustainability strategy. But we've all got the information to do this. Now, I see when HS2 if it eventually starts progressing, some of the more ambitious tender questions will start to filter down the construction industry. But the world's largest ethical sustainability leadership programme is called the United Nations Global Compact. Don't put off by the fact that it's run by the United Nations. It's applicable to all businesses. If we take a more a rather traditional sustainability model, which is a mixture of the economy, social and community factors, and environmental factors, Global Compact takes this one step further and considers labour, environment, human rights, and anti-corruption. Don't forget, this is an international scheme. Luckily in the UK, a lot of people are protected by law, but we may be engaging supply chains that may be buying from overseas, and are we protecting our reputation from some of these elements? I got dragged into looking at battery recycling, and the further you look down the supply chain, the murkier it got. We looked into it and we did get a legal resolution at the end of it. They were being disposed of in the UK. But how do we know they weren't going for conflict minerals or for this and that and being used, forced labour being used on them? We don't know until you look into it. So the United Nations Global Compact acts on 10 principles. I'm not going to read them out, but it's between human rights and protecting people, labour and being responsible employers, and as I said, thankfully in the UK, a lot of these principles are illegal, so discrimination, forced labour in the UK is illegal, but how do we know our supply chains aren't promoting some of this? The environment's precautionary approach, responsible management of the environment, and looking at environmentally friendly technologies. And anti-corruption, how we're protecting our businesses against this. Now, applying this, we look at the core business activities, so we look at what we're doing as an organisation, what our supply chain are doing, how we're interacting with the community, and public policy and advocacy. Now, community interaction, public policy and advocacy, you're meeting today by being here. You're engaging with our partners from InvestSefton. You're being involved in the business community. So there's a lot of people who advise on this who overcomplicate it, and they make it into an academic subject. It needn't be. If you want to look into it in an academic basis, great, you go for it. But if you want to apply this to your business practices, keep it simple. And what this recognises, you'll have a decreasing influence the further into the supply chain. So by engaging on these theories, don't think that you've got to be advising on public policy and influencing it. No, it could be engaging with local authority, engaging with planning applications and the like. That's how you interact. Now, in terms of practical application of this, to bring your ethical and professional reasoning and rationale into a measurable scheme, the 17 Sustainable Development Goals. If you wanted to map your current business activities against these, I see if you're applying, especially for public sector contracts and contracts with major suppliers, this is already appearing in the tender stage and being required by businesses. But don't be put off by it. Think about mapping these 17 principles for your own business. And as I've said, there are people dying to save your money who really overcomplicate this. There's no need to. If you want more information on this, please drop me a line. I have written a quite digestible briefing paper on Global Compact and the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, with some advice on how we can map it for your own business. So that brings me to the end of my... Brilliant. If you want more information on this, I publish some mildly useful videos on my YouTube channel, which includes some specialist ones for training surveyors. And I also publish some paid professional courses on the Udemy training platform. So thanks very much for a whistle-stop tour through a very large subject. I'd be delighted if you connect with me on LinkedIn, on Twitter, or visit the YouTube channel. So that brings me to the end of my presentation. Are there any questions? I'm going to hang around a little bit after. There's another, can grab, sneak another coffee in there. I'd be delighted to talk to you. Thanks so much for listening, and we better move on.